All right, guys, welcome to the SML Show presented by Yamaha and OGIO Powersports. Today we have an awesome guest. I'm super excited about it. Tennessee's own Mike Brown.
Yeah, nice to be here. Thank you for having me on. This is my second time and I'm looking forward to it.
I'm excited. I'm a Tennessee guy myself. You know, I'm from the west side. I guess you're from Eastern Tennessee.
Yeah. Muddy Creek,
yes. I grew up racing there, man. Like, my main memory of them is that they always tilled up the landings of the jumps.
Yeah.
And then they just put wood chips everywhere, right?
Now
you know, I remember showing up and like you being there, Jim Neese, Zach Osborne, Kevin Walker, all those guys. So how was it growing up in Tennessee, like with the winters being like super cold, rainy? How was it training in that sort of thing, like whenever you're coming up as an amateur?
Yeah, it was hard. The thing I can look back and see is when I got the first ride being from Pro Circuit on the Honda Peak Honda team. I never rode Supercross in my life until I went to California. They took me to Simi Valley where the Honda track used to be with Supercross suspension and put on the track then. I never rode a Supercross. It was winter time. You don't, like you say, if you don't go to Florida and ride Crooms back then, you didn't ride at all. So
yeah.
It's hard. You had to travel around, and back then a lot of people didn't do the traveling and moving to Florida, moving to California. So it was different. Now it's, if you're not moving and traveling and being in the right place, it ain't gonna work.
Yeah. So being from Tennessee, there was a couple pro guys coming from Tennessee. I mean, it was mainly you and the two I think of, right? It's Mike Brown and Nate Ramsey.
Yeah.
Growing up, did you race with Nate at all, or was he a little bit after you?
He was after me for sure. But I watched him grow up. I knew him when he was riding novice class, and the next month he's in the pro class. He's like, well, I ain't gonna ride novice class. I ain't gonna get no better, so I go to pro class. But no, Nate's. I've grown up watching him for a while.
Yeah, man, that's awesome. I mean, Tennessee, it's a great place to grow up. You know, like the summer times, it's real nice and humid. It'll make a man out of you
for sure.
But so my main question, I'm gonna just get straight to it right off the bat. 2001, outdoors. You know, going into the last round, it was a dogfight the whole year between you and Grant Langston. What was your sort of like mentality that whole year? Take me through like some of like the struggles you had, and then you know like the highs and lows.
The highs is just being competitive every weekend. That was a good thing. Knowing you're going to the race, you're going for the win. You ain't going like you're a fifth place guy. I was going to, for me, it was going to win every weekend. And I think what brought that on was coming the year before when Langston raced in Europe, and he kind of kicked their butt there. So that year it was, you know, we had a crazy rivalry, but I think that's what, for me, made me push every weekend because I wanted to beat him as bad as he wanted to beat me. And it was, you know, every weekend was intense on that side of like, you know, and then you throw Rhino and the other guys in, and it just, every weekend was just like a different feeling than I would have any other time of my racing career.
Wow, man. So like, going into that last round, I think you were 6 points down. He had to win, I think, right?
Yep.
He had to win like the last round
to
wrap up the title. Like how, like, and then I think you crashed in the parade lap too. Were you just like hands up, you're like, oh man, like, what's going on here?
Yeah, I think I was the first moto I crashed on a hot lap, muddy gloves and everything. And you know, sometimes it's like back in the day when you had two strokes and you foul a spark plug, you always get a good start after you get the plug back in. Your adrenaline's going, I think. Then I was like, man, I was just all jittery and I was ready. And the first moto, I got the good start and got the win. And it was, the second moto was even better than that.
Yeah.
But it was,
that's awesome.
Started out bad, but.
Yeah, man, I feel like you've raced everybody, right? I mean, you've raced Ricky, you've raced James, you raced GL, all of these people. Who was, I guess, like the gnarliest rivalry that you had? Like who was the hardest guy to race against?
I would say Rhino.
Rhino?
Yeah, because we always just butted heads, or, you know, it's like I wanted to be the best B rider. He wanted to be, you know, we grew up Team Green through the Loretta's, through the A class, into the pros. And, you know, I think me and him was always, even until we stopped racing, we were like, you know, banging bars. And that's good. But, you know, and Grant was too, just that one year in Europe I raced with him. It was kind of the same, but for sure Rhino.
Yeah. Like, shoot, man, whenever I think Mike Brown, I just think just a dog fighter, just someone who has like the most motivation, like who's just there every time wanting to win, no matter what it is, whether it be on a bicycle, in the gym, riding a dirt bike, all of it. Is that just something that just you were born with growing up, or is it something you had to learn?
No, I've been like that from day one. It doesn't matter if I'm riding a skateboard or what, I like to win. And it's you got to have that. It's hard to teach that, but it's like anything. I was telling him, I went to Italy a few weeks ago to Majora, and they had like a vet race, and it was a vet race. We didn't even take off the starting gate. We run your bikes, but it was the race was on. I wanted to win to the bike, you know, run to the bike. I was, you know, it was all on for me, and there were some good kids there, but it doesn't matter. Like, if I went to the Supercross this Saturday night with Anaheim, I must go to win. It's not like that's, and I know, I'm not going to win. But if you don't have that mentality and you can't teach that to a lot of kids these days, it's not going to work.
I mean, I was even watching that, I think I was on YouTube, right? And they had like the vet designations. Is that what you were talking about?
Yeah. No, this is the week after. Another one. But that one, that was with Villopoto and them.
Yeah, with Villopoto and Zach Osborne.
Yeah.
And I'm watching the race and you're beating these guys. I mean, these guys are, you know, I wouldn't say half your age, but I mean, they're quite a bit younger.
Yeah.
And you're just whooping up on these boys, you know?
Yeah, it's just, I think for me, like, that's a big change for people going back and riding older bikes, you say, but they're still, I think where I've rubbed so many disciplines of different bikes, and over the years from two strokes to four strokes, a lot of kids now, they don't even know what a two stroke is hardly. And it's hard to adapt to, you know, go back to a two stroke. And I think that's what's helped me just riding so many other variety of bikes.
So now that you mentioned that, that actually leads me to my next question. You've ridden for so many teams. You've ridden every single brand of bike, right? I mean, you rode for Pro Circuit. You've rode for Yamaha Troy. Was it FMF Honda?
No, I didn't do that one. No,
you didn't do that one. And then you had Rockstar Suzuki.
Yep.
You know, you're riding Huskies. What was maybe your best bike and your worst bike?
I've had a lot of good bikes. You know, you always want to say when your best year you win is the Pro Circuit 125. For sure, in 125 days, Pro Circuit was the best bike I've ridden on a 125, like as a race team. Been on a lot of four-stroke teams. I did the HRC factory team in Europe for two years over there, which was good bikes. Enjoyed that there. But overall, as a professional team back then, was for sure Mitch.
Yeah.
And I rode for the Rinaldi team in 97 in Europe, and it was a factory Yamaha 250 then, and it was unreal too. But that was, and being in Europe at those time of years where they change the whole bike completely for you, was that was a eye-awakening there.
Yeah, because in the U.S. you can't really change, you can't do much to the frame or anything
nothing
like that. In Europe, anything goes.
Yeah, you go up and you test 10 frames and 20 swing arms, and you know, it's all different. So it's a big difference from there to here from that situation.
So whenever you went over there to Europe, I mean, you probably hadn't experienced that, right? So how much difference and how much better were the bikes over there versus over here?
I don't know if they was a lot better. I think you can fine tune them a little bit more, but me being my first year on a 250 really that year, it could have been a stock bike for me. It would have been, you know what I mean? I didn't know much about a 250, and for me, a 250 was like a 500 back then compared to now. So it was a learning curve for me on a 250, which helped me in my career, getting up on that bike and getting strong. But yeah, you could do whatever you want to make the bike over there. And Talon was my teammate, Volan, and he was good at testing stuff. And so that helped me get a better bike for myself.
Yeah. And then coming from Tennessee, just taking a plane all the way to Europe, that had to have been something that was like a little bit foreign to you.
And I was there for 10 months and not come home. So yeah, that was big.
I'm sure I'm sure it took a bit of time to get used to the food, right?
Yeah, in Italy in a small town, nobody spoke English. And it was tough for first. Like I said, I did cry a few times, I had to admit.
Yeah. Well, all right, guys, that leads us into our first commercial break. We'll be back with more. Mike Brown.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Maldet.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Marvin Muskin.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jalen Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
All right, guys. Welcome back to the SML Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. So before, I guess, all these four strokes came out, right? Everybody was on two strokes. You were a part of that transition between 125s and 250Fs.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you, towards the end of your career, right, you raced a 250F. I think it was on Yamaha Troy.
Yep.
But before that, you were on 125s. Was there ever a time where the teams brought both bikes to the test track, say they brought a 125 and a 250F and told you guys, like, hey, test each one and whichever one you're faster on, you guys can race that for a year? Or was it like?
I never did. I went from when I was on the Kawasaki team, and the next year, the 125, they were coming with the four stroke, and Mitch just wanted me to stay with that there. I never tried them back to back. And then I ended up going to Yamaha Choi, and it was straight four strokes then. I never got a chance to try back to back like that there.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I was curious because I was watching some YouTube videos because I'm a huge fan, come from Tennessee and all that.
Yeah.
05 Broome Tioga.
Yeah.
It was when James actually wrapped up the title. You guys got into a little bit of a dogfight there at the beginning. You were on a 250F. He was on a 125. So was it an advantage at all riding a 250F at that point in time, or was it still new?
For me, it was new. I would have probably done better on a 125.
Okay.
I was still trying to learn how to ride it that year. It was my first year, and over revving it, and, you know, riding it like a two-stroke, which wasn't the way to ride the four-stroke. So maybe it would have hurt me a little bit. I think I got better on it as the year went on, but I would have probably been better on a 125, I think.
Yeah. Do you remember that race at all?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. You remember like the whole like practice thing and you guys going back and forth?
Practice. The practice on like when they had practice on Friday, it started there. And
maybe that's why it bothered you so much, like in the races, you guys had y'all's little back and forth thing in practice, you and James, and then the next day you had to sleep on it and think about it that whole night. And I'm sure like with you, like you're just like. Ugh.
It was in practice on Friday, and you know what happened that year, same year I think, or no, it was a year before at Glen Helm, when his first national for him. We got together, I think it was maybe the first lap, going down one of the hills to the 180, going back up, and both of us end up crashing. And same there, as you come down before you get back onto the start there, we got together in a big crash, and then, like you said, it carried on to Sunday.
Yeah.
Sunday morning's first moto, I think it was, or whatever, but. Bad thing was, he still came back and beat me that moto.
Yeah, well, I mean, the thing about you, though, like, you're not going to let any, it doesn't matter, though.
No.
You're not going to let anyone push you around, right?
Yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah. No, you can't. If they do, they see that, they take it every weekend.
Yeah, for sure. But, man, like, I don't know, just watching you guys wrung the necks off the 125s back there. And like,
yeah.
I feel like, I don't know if you agree with it at all, but I think the racing was maybe a little bit better whenever it was 125s.
I think the racing was good because you had to make everything inch count on the track. You're pushing in the corners, you're doing everything. Now it's, and I love four strokes, but it feels like it makes you a lazy kind of a rider. You can get in the corner and just, the bike's so quick coming out. I think the racing is much better. I was telling somebody last weekend, and even in Europe, and I was talking to that Vet Worlds with Villapoto, I was thinking, man, it feels like, you think we'd go as fast on the two strokes now that we would have been? Because I hated 250 two strokes when I was racing. Mm-hmm. They were like I said, it was like riding a 500. I was scared of them.
Yeah.
But now I'm on a 250 over there, and I'm like wide open places, like the fastest bike would go. And I feel like, man, I feel like I'm going as fast now on the bike as the guys were going back then.
Yeah.
And I always wonder like that. But it's like riding 80 now compared to 450s on the 250s.
Yeah,
it's a big difference.
Crazy how much power these bikes have nowadays.
Yeah.
So you're working at Alden's now with like some of the guys.
Yep.
How was that, right? Like, I mean, you're working with like this younger group, and you have these guys coming up. I guess you're giving them like all the knowledge, right? Because you've been there, you've done it all.
Yeah.
You know, is it tough at times? Like, does it get frustrating whenever, you know, they're not doing something that you agree with, or if they're struggling with it?
It is tough. I mean, you see all the work going during the week, and they go through the weekend, and it's like just useless, really. But they all, most of them, like they do work hard. They work harder during the week than they do in the weekends, which makes sense. But you want to see the results, and come Monday morning again, like, what happened? Oh man, I keep crashing. Why do you keep crashing? You know, it's like they never have an example. You can't win crashing, so the other guys ain't crashing, they're winning. So it's like, it's some don't ever change. Like I love the mentality of, you know, listen to them, what happened, this, that. It's great being around that way, and
yeah,
I enjoy helping them. That's the main thing. Like now, I was out this week now in California helping Tom Viales, which is, he's a kid that's, he likes to work. He's
that's
not scared to do laps. He's not scared to do, you know what I mean? He's a worker, and I think that's, we got those back there, but it's hard to get it out. Some kids, like, it's hard to teach them that.
Yeah, I feel like sometimes you have a kid who's been handed everything, right? Yeah. His whole amateur career, and he yeah. hasn't really, you know, had to, like, dig through the trenches to get something
exactly.
like what he wants, right? And maybe that's sometimes reflects on, like, their work ethic,
yeah.
you know? And then, like, you have, you know, guys like you who are, like, totally different, have, like, the mentality of just, like, hey, put in the work, do
yeah.
it,
yeah, yeah.
with no questions asked.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I'm not, like, I'm a probably overdoer. Like, when I was training with Ricky and before, and I never knew about Epstein Barr, I never knew, oh, man, I'm tired, I'm going to ease up. No, it never was like that. And it's probably the wrong way now, but you see guys, I see what I've done and what Ricky's done, what other guys have done training-wise, and now it's like, man, we can't do that. That's too much. That's too much.
Yeah.
Like, you can't fight with them because they're not going to do it. And it's just like, all right, we'll see how it goes this weekend.
Back in the day, was that just like a myth? Or like, did they just didn't even know what Epstein-Barr was?
Yeah, for sure. I heard of it. And, you know, Elda knows more about that side of it than I do. But I would never even really thought about it. You know what I mean? You heard, I think Emig and him had it. And some of them guys had it early on in their career, like back then. And, you know, it wasn't thought of as it now, like it was.
Yeah.
But
so who is your favorite? Who's like, I mean, you've had a lot of people come through Alden's, you know, program that you've worked with. Say, who is one of like your favorites that you like to work with the most? Like, who's like cracking up and maybe like having a little bit too much fun in the
Last in the 2 years has been good with having Dino and Jalik and Styles there. Like, as in like having fun and cracking up. Stuff they say is unreal. Like, it's it needs to be, like I always say, we need a reality show in this room right here, because it's, and you can imagine Dean and Jalik together. Yeah. It can get rough sometimes, but no, they're good guys. They mean well, and it's quiet now right there. Like, all I have right now is Jalik and Max and young Casey Cochran there.
Oh,
so
okay.
it's kind of quiet, and then Tom goes back next weekend and join in with that crew.
Yeah, it seems like with that type of crew, it kind of keeps you young and on your toes, huh?
Oh, for sure. That's what I keep racing for, and I enjoy like being around watching. You know, you can learn as much watching guys, how they ride and do that, and then when I ride, I'm like, oh, I got to try that. I seen this guy do that. I'm going to see if that works. And it's not the same, but you know, that's what keeps me young and thinking and in the sport. If I wasn't around that, and no, I wouldn't probably ride a motorcycle.
All right, guys. Well, let's take another quick break to hear from our sponsors. All right, guys, welcome back to the SML Show with Mike Brown, the absolute legendary Tennessee guy who's just been a racer just straight from the womb. I mean, and how old are you now?
50.
50. And just still a racer. We got World Vets coming up, right?
This weekend, yeah.
Oh, really, man. Just a man. Like, racing, how many classes are you going to sign up for?
Well, my sponsor over here has got me signed up for 4 classes.
Oh, man.
It's going to be a tough weekend, especially putting up with Kiefer on my wheel or in front of me or whatever. But yeah, it should be good.
Yeah, man, just a racer. Like, I remember there's been times where you and I have went on bike rides and just, like, you can just tell that, like, even going up the hill, like, say if someone just were to show a wheel on you, you just hate that, right? Like,
yeah.
You just want to win all the time. Like, that's just crazy to think, man. Like, I don't know. I try to have that mentality, but it just, something most of the time just doesn't work out.
Yeah. But everywhere. I mean, sometimes, yeah, for me, it never works out, but like I said, you got to have that going into it. Yeah. And like you said, yeah, you try it, but like, yeah, if you don't have that, then what are you going to do?
Yeah.
Get beat even worse.
So when I think Mike Brown, I always think just the huge number 3 on the number plate, right? Yep. I mean, that was like awesome to think. I don't even think about Eli Tomac whenever he has his number 3, right? Yeah. I just think about Mike Brown because you had it for so many years. How many years did you actually have it?
From 02 till 14.
14?
15, yeah.
Yeah. So you were still, you would do like the nationals each year and you would try to get, what was it, 25 points?
Yeah, because I came back from Europe and I went off-road, so then I had to do a couple races those years to get 25 points or whatever.
Yeah,
and then when I went to Husky, they didn't have the homologation rule, so I couldn't race the whole 1 year.
Yeah.
And then that's when I lost the whole thing, and then, yeah, Tomac took it. So.
Man, so how old were you whenever you were still getting these 25 points in outdoors? You did a couple Supercrosses a few years as well, right?
No,
or did you just do the outdoors?
Last Supercross, just the outdoors. Yeah, it would have been 14, so it would have been... Yeah, 42, 43
years old, still going out there and just whooping up on the
41,
young
kids. Yeah, something like that. I thought I was whooping. I did good at Southwick 1 year.
Yeah.
I almost gotten third there. I think we tied up for a lot of places. I ended up getting fifth or sixth there. But
yeah. You and Dowdy, just freaking running it over there at Southwick.
But this guy, I love the sand. It was nice, rough tracks.
So, I don't know, man. Growing up in Tennessee, the winters are rough. Winters are rough. So did you go down to Florida every single year? Or
either California back earlier on in my career, I'd go there. And then when I started training with Ricky in 2000, I actually trained with Ricky when I was in Europe racing. I'd go there and stay December and January and ride outdoor stuff before I went to Europe. So, I'd go to, and then when Supercross was on, when he was in California, I was in California. So then we'd go back to Florida and stay the rest of the time. But, yeah, I haven't trained in Tennessee as in wintertime, and it's been many years.
Yeah.
Not used to the cold. I don't like
it very much. No. Like, I went back home a couple weeks ago, and it was like, it started getting cold, and I'm like, man, I need to get back to California.
It's a big difference when you get older, for sure. It gets worse.
Yeah. I remember I had a Supercross track in my backyard, and I'm like, man, I can't be doing this.
How'd
like, it's
do
way
that?
Too cold. Hands are cold. You can't hang on. You're trying to go through the whoops, and hands flying off because they're all numb. So. Yeah, that's whenever I decided, I was like, man, I got to get out of here to California.
Yeah, I was at Muddy Creek the last race a few weeks ago, and it was practice at 8 o'clock, was 31 degrees in the morning. I came back, lips are all chapped and froze, your fingers are froze off, and it's...
Yeah, I did one of those races at Muddy Creek one time, down the stair steps. I think the ground was frozen. I got the whole shot, and I'm going down the stair steps, and the ground was frozen. I washed the front end, dude. I did not stop tumbling until I got all the way down to the bottom.
To the bottom. Yeah.
Yeah, that dirt was deceiving, right?
It is. Like, yeah, it looks grippy.
It looks amazing, but man, it's like glass underneath.
Especially if it gets frozen like that, it's dangerous.
So you grew up racing the Rettas. You know, you grew up through the amateur class, you know, and now even after being a pro, you're still racing the Rettas. What was the first year you raced the Rettas? Did you get a championship? Like, were your like, who was your rival?
No, 87 was my first year there on the 80, I think it was. I didn't get a championship, but that's the same year I grew up racing with McGrath.
Okay.
We were at Loretta's together in the novice class racing, and I think I won. He maybe won a motor, and I won. But we were battling in the novice class there.
Mm-hmm.
Then I think he came to Loretta's and did 125, and I stayed back on the 80 because I was doing both then.
Yeah.
And then 88 was my first year, I think, to win a championship there in the B class.
Oh, nice. Okay. Yeah. And then that sort of like, I guess, was like a rollerball effect. Like everything started coming together a
little bit better. Yeah. Because I got the team green ride. And then, you know, I was one of the top team green riders there for a couple of years. And I was wanting to move out of that to get into the pro ranks. And they just want me to stay in the amateur stuff. And then I split up, did my own thing, and did supercrosses after that there. So,
yeah.
But yeah, that Loretta's is, you know, it's a big stepping stone for everybody.
How was your transition coming from amateur class to professional?
A lot different it is now. Back then, you know, I won Loretta's in the B and A class, still didn't have a factory ride or anything. Mm-hmm. So that's when I decided to do my own thing. In 91, I did my own thing with Jim's Motorcycle Sales and and did good that year in the Nationals and did good in the Supercross and ended up getting a ride with Mitch. But it was kind of like a trial-based thing. Through Supercross, yeah, you do. If you don't do it, then you're gone. And yeah, it didn't work for me. But I, back then, I didn't know how to train. I didn't do anything. I didn't have a Supercross track to practice. So it was hard for me to get used to the Supercross stuff.
And now, I mean, you're doing like the whole vet thing, right? I mean, you're going to Loretta's every year. You're racing against Kiefer. You have to hear that whole thing each week, you know.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, how many Loretta Lynn's championships do you have now? I mean, you've been racking them up each year, right?
I think 11 or 12, I think it is. Oh, yeah? I have, yeah.
So Alessi doesn't have like the most amount of championships.
No, he's close, but I think Kevin Walker actually has the most, 15.
15, yeah. Okay. So do you see yourself getting that record?
I don't know. I think if Lessie stays around, he might be able to get it, but I don't know.
Not a single hole shot from him this year.
I know. Them guys are fast this year.
Oh,
glad I wasn't in that class this year.
You wasn't in the 25 this year?
Not this year, no.
Oh, man.
I got out at the right time.
Yeah. So what's your plan moving forward? You're doing Minios. Now, is it tough with Alden? Like, is he allowing you to do these races, or is it kind of like a?
He does. I mean, he does. I'm sure he never says no. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He knows I like to race. When I first went there, no, sit on the bike. He told me, please don't get on the bike. I don't need you hurt. Which I understand. That's not my job. And I said, all right, I didn't do it. And then he just came up to me right before Loretta's 2 years ago, I think it was, like Friday before it starts. Said, hey, man. Why don't you go do Loretta's? I'm thinking, okay, I'll try to get entry.
Yeah.
So I was on the reserve list, didn't make it in. I made it in one class, and I decided not to race because I hadn't rode any. But now he's good. He's like coming here, and you know, him and Andy are good friends, so it helps out being on that side of letting me go race.
Was that tough, not being able to race?
It was, because when I came to work for Eldon's, I was still racing a lot as an amateur with Yamaha, and I was doing pretty good. I was probably riding good as then as I ever had my whole life. And I was doing all the local big money race and doing good at that stuff. And, you know, to go straight in and not ride anymore and give up all the Yamaha support, which I wanted a job, and that's what I gave up. So, but now it's better now as it is, because I get to do both. I can still ride when I want and be a part of Baker Factory. It's good, because I've kind of been with Eldon ever since he's been in America. Since day one, I've been with him. And we have a good relationship, and you know, I believe in this program. You know, I think everybody's program is not far off.
Right?
Yeah, it is for sure. And a lot of people say, oh, it's no good, but I know a lot of the trainers do the same thing we do. It's not, and you know, it's all the same day, the same thing at the end of the day.
So how much do you actually get to ride at Alden's? Do you get to ride much or not at all?
No, I mean, I probably rode a total of 12 times at this track. And this year is the most I ever rode there. Before Loretta's, 2 weeks, I rode with the guys on the track for 2 weeks every day they rode. So that's the most I've done, really. I don't ride there ever.
Really?
Because it's not open on the weekends. And in the daytimes, I either go to the gym or I'm doing something different. So I don't really have time to ride there.
Do you ever, like, just during the outdoor prep, do you ever just want to get on a bike and just, like, show these kids, like, hey, like, this is how you freaking do it?
Some days, but dang, you know how hot it is there.
Oh, yeah.
It's like you walk outside in the morning at 6:30 to go to work, and you're already sweating. It's like, man, I'm glad I ain't riding today. But I do miss it. Like, I do like the hot days. I'd rather it be 110 out than 70, you know. But it is fun watching them. Like, you see a nice corner and hit that corner. It's like, man, I wish I had my gear on, you know. But it was good. Like, one day I got on somebody's bike, and it's like, man, go hit them whoops. Yeah, I geared up and hit the whoops on one of the guys' bikes. He's like, no way, you can't hit the whoops. And like, didn't even look at him. Hit the triple first lap. Shifted to fourth, threw the whoops.
Just like, hey, that's how you do it.
The young kid, like, some of the kids are still there, but they couldn't believe it. But
yeah.
I enjoy the enjoy your riding and having fun. Like, you know, it'd be hard as being a job like these guys now. It's tough.
So you're a brand ambassador for FXR now, right? You've ridden, you know, for all these teams. You've worn all this crazy different types of gear. You've raced in Europe, right? Wore all their crazy gear over there too. What is the most like craziest standout set of gear, and then what is the main thing that has changed from say 1991 to 2023, 22?
I think the change is the way this stuff fits. You know, you look at the old pictures, the baggy stuff, and it's flying around, and now it's like today I was at the track and some of the guys, how tight it is, I don't see how they move, but the way it fits. But when you put it on, it's totally different, and the stuff is stretchy now, and it feels really comfortable like that. But I think the material is they use now is a big change. Like back then, it was super thick, you know, nothing.
Cloth jerseys. Breathable.
Yeah, cloth jerseys with the heat transfer on the back. They didn't breathe, you know, it was just a big deal, and you're slashing your jerseys up to get air. I think just the quality of material, the way they're made, the stretchy, and then the colors now, like it's just like the changing of everything. You know, you go to the Dago colors, and then it's to the gray colors, and now we're back to, you know, it's
the more crazy
designs. Yes. Sometimes a couple of years they're really basic fit, but the FXR is, I've been with them for probably going on 7 years now, and me as being as a rider, as trying the stuff on, and Andy, you know, getting the right product out there is, it's been a big change for I think the gear companies, and now you see an FXR.
Yeah,
it's
coming
everywhere.
From Canada to the U.S., like it's blowing up.
Yeah, it's big, and you know, it's kind of the trend is Fox and Fly, all those guys, and now it's FXR is battling with those guys. And like I said, the quality of stuff they make is top for sure.
That's awesome. Yeah, I remember like the cloth jerseys, like I think they were mentioning like the Thor jerseys that was super baggy.
Super baggy.
Right?
The arms are down here, and it's like a parachute kind of thing.
But
it's crazy the difference of how big they've come in a short amount of time. Like it's they're really good quality.
Yeah. So last question. Maybe you did this, maybe you didn't, I don't know. But in 2001, whenever you got the championship, was there anything that like you wanted to buy like the whole year? Say, hey, if I got that championship bonus, like I'm gonna get this.
No, I did buy a car. I bought a Porsche Carrera Turbo or whatever, one of those. And I've probably had it for 3 years and put 1,400 miles on it and lost my butt on it, but I had one.
Oh, man. Well, all right, guys. That concludes our Mike Brown interview for the SML Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. And
thanks for having me, Ray. I appreciate it.
Yeah, man. I'm just in shock right now that I'm interviewing Mike Brown, Tennessee's own. So it's great. All right,
appreciate
guys.
Appreciate it.
Later.